Professor Maharaj, distinguished members of the Board of Management, Academic Council and Planning Board, members of the IGNOU community, dear students, ladies and gentlemen, it is to me a matter of privilege and pleasure to extend to you all a cordial welcome. We are thankful to Professor James Maharaj, the President of the Commonwealth of Learning, for his kind acceptance to be the chief guest and deliver the convocation address. Professor Maharaj is a friend of all of us, a philosopher and guide to the distance education system in India, and may I say, a patron of IGNOU in all its endeavors. And from today, he will also be a distinguished alumnus of this university, since we are to confer on him shortly the degree of Doctor of Letters honoris causa. The IGNOU recognizes, acknowledges, and expresses its appreciation in this form, the services rendered, the leadership role played, and the creative contributions made by him to education in general and to distance education in particular. He takes his place among two other eminent men we honored in the past, namely Sir S. Rampal, the Secretary General of the Commonwealth, and Professor G. Ram Reddy, the first Vice-Chancellor of the University and now Chairman, University Grants Commission. In order to comprehend and appreciate the developments that have taken place, I must mention the functions assigned to IGNOU and the role it has come to play as it has evolved and grown, and as we now visualize the goals and directions of its development. One, it is an open university per se, with objectives as laid down in the Act. Two, it has also been mandated by the Act to perform the functions of coordination and determination of standards of distance education systems in the country. Three, by virtue of the manpower and material resources that it has developed, the university is also slowly but decisively emerging as a resource center in distance education for the developing countries in this region. The university is just 8 years old and is still an infant institution. It has seen a rapid, may I say, sir, unprecedented growth and is today the largest open university in the Commonwealth countries. We will be admitting this year around 82,000 students, and our total enrollment will touch 220,000. We offer now 57 programs and nearly 370 courses. We have taken courage to enter such areas as health sciences, engineering and technology, and computer applications. A school of legal studies has been newly established, and this brings the total number of schools to 10. We have a vast network of 16 regional centers and 219 study centers. We have added 10 new study centers or sub-centers, bringing the total to 229. With the introduction of programs in health sciences, engineering and computer applications, we have developed the concept of work centers for practical training, and we propose to establish around 80 work centers. One can get an idea of the dimensions of our student services from the fact that during the year under review, we conducted 70,000 counseling sessions using the services of academic counselors from a panel of over 11,000 counselors. We dispatched on an average 3,000 mails every day, the number touching 4,000 per day during the peak periods. An open university makes use of multimedia instruction. The university has produced 476 video and 573 audio programs. The quality of our print material, as well as audio-video cassettes, is acknowledged to be high. As an example, I am happy to inform you that the Commonwealth of Learning has purchased the rights of 26 of our cassettes for use in some of the Commonwealth countries. We telecast our lessons 3 days a week, half an hour each day. We suffer from a crippling handicap in that we do not have the facility of using in an adequate measure the All India Radio for broadcasting. which alone can really help to reach the places and people so far unreached, which is our motto. It is my considered opinion, sir, that distance education in this country cannot develop to its full dimensions and potential unless it uses communication technology in all its forms. I must confess that in spite of all our efforts, our student services in general need to be improved. It is perhaps our Achilles heel, and we are constantly endeavoring to bring about greater efficiency in performance at all levels. In this convocation, 7,580 candidates qualify for certificates, diplomas, and degrees. It is a steep increase from 4,444 last year, and I expect that the number will touch 10,000 next year and grow further. Our examination operations are massive and formidable. We conduct terminal examinations in 184 centers spread over the length and breadth of the country twice a year, each time lasting over 3 weeks, and nationwide entrance examination in addition to that for more than one program, all with part-time staff at all the examination centers. We have a unique record of continuous evaluation. We have handled nearly 1,40,000 answer books and 470,000 assignments during the year under review. I made a reference to IGNOU as an apex body for coordination and determination of standards of distance education systems in the country. The Board of Management has set up as an authority of the university a distance education council. Tangible progress has been made in arriving at, by mutual consent, standardization of the data collection, the definition of credits, and content of certificate, diploma, and degree programs. New measures are on to establish a quality assurance committee. The IGNOU has also made a beginning in academic audit, a new venture in quality evaluation. We often tend to think that paucity of funds is the only constraint in expanding and developing education. In the modern world, qualified manpower is becoming a major constraint, and distance education needs well-trained staff at all levels. To meet this need, we have established a staff training and research institute in distance education with significant assistance from the Commonwealth of Learning. This institute is already blossoming into a training resource center, not only for India, but also for the developing countries in this region. I made a reference to the need for using communication technology in distance education. I am happy to inform you that a project for improving the educational media production facilities of Indira Gandhi National Open University has been approved and taken up under a grant in aid project from Japan. The massive project, costing about rupees 48 crores, when completed in about a year, will perhaps be the most modern facility in the country in this area of activity. We have just established, with full assistance again from the Commonwealth of Learning, RDO teleconferencing facility, connecting the IGNOU headquarters with all the 16 regional centers and the 3 open universities. While on this subject, I must make a reference to an extremely important development. The Commonwealth of Learning has a project for establishing a Commonwealth Education Media Center for Asia. I am happy and proud to announce that the Commonwealth of Learning has decided that this Center for Asia will be located in IGNOU. Sir, we are thankful to the Commonwealth of Learning. As you are aware, that it was in the last convocation that the Commonwealth of Learning conferred on us the distinction of Center of Excellence in Distance Education. Following closely on the heels of this development, the heads of Commonwealth governments who met in Cyprus in October 1993 announced the award of 100 fellowships in IGNOU under the auspices of the Commonwealth of Learning. I am happy to inform you that candidates from 19 developing countries in the African, Asian, Caribbean, and Pacific regions will pursue IGNOU programs through distance education mode from their respective places. The fellowships are to be formally presented to Indira Gandhi National Open University at a function day after tomorrow, that is on 18/4/94. We have introduced, starting from this year, a scheme of university gold medals for the first rank holders in various programs. 16 programs have been identified for this convocation, and 14 candidates are receiving the medals in person today. All of us must congratulate them on their outstanding performance. As for the finances of the university, there has been a steady increase in the revenue receipts year after year. The revenue generated by the university during 92-93 accounts for 45% of the operational expenditure. The percentage of expenditure on full-time staff as against the total revenue expenditure works out to be less than 30%. A steady progress is being maintained in the campus development program. Quarters numbering 264 are under construction. Tender is being invited for the construction of the school sub-studies, library, computer division, Delhi Regional Center, bank, and a guest house cum hostel. The university has been receiving requests for establishing study centers abroad. There is now a perceptible global trend of open universities for establishing study centers in other countries. The IGNO has received requests from countries abroad for establishing study centers. The proposals from Dubai and Abu Dhabi are under examination. Since its inception, the university has benefited immensely from assistance under the Overseas Development Administration Program of the United Kingdom by way of consultants, training for our staff, and equipment. The third phase of ODA program has come to an end, and a review is to be made in June 1994. We hope that our proposal for the fourth phase will receive favorable consideration. The Open University, even in advanced countries, has less than three decades of tradition. In India, it has a brief history. Expansion and development of IGNO has been, and is, a matter of experimentation and learning from experience. It is often difficult to reconcile scholarly pursuits with quantitative performance. Norms and regulations inhibit creativity, but without norms and regulations, it is difficult to ensure certain level of productivity. The maintenance of a balance needs mature academic and industrial operations. The IGNO has so far maintained a tradition of quality and productivity. Whatever it has been able to achieve is due to the sum total of the contributions made by many whose names may not be heard, whose faces may not be seen. The few of us who are players on the stage are but their images. We remember, recognize, and acknowledge the contributions made by all of them. I am confident that the IGNO community has the value system and the motivation to fulfill the objectives set when the nation gave unto itself this institution named after one of India's most illustrious leaders. Thank you very much.